Can you hold her head, Nate? We just need to tip slightly that way.
Gina?
She's just going to spew.
Can we get some anti-emetic, David, please?
We don't yet know the extent of the injuries around her head and her neck.
Do you feel like you're swallowing stuff?
Yeah. I'm sorry, that's really sore, isn't it? Yeah. Ongoing bleeding might put her airway at risk.
Can you open any wider than that?
No.
Worried that we're not going to be able to lie her down and get her flat to go in the scanner.
We don't know whether she'll obstruct her airway at that point. And if she obstructs her airway, she can die.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I
stabbing to the chest.
Oh. The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
We're going to look after you. Set up a drip, did you say? Oh, yeah, no dramas.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, nurse Ebony Cameron has just celebrated two amazing milestones, 10 years in the emergency department and her wedding day.
Our wedding day was amazing. It was everything that we wanted. My dad had had cancer a couple of years ago, and there was points in our time where we weren't sure if he was going to be able to walk me down the aisle. So having him there on that day was obviously very emotional. And then after our wedding, we went on a honeymoon to Mexico. It was warm nights and amazing cocktails, and we couldn't think of anywhere else that we'd rather be. I'm a very lucky girl, very happy girl. Never been so happy in my life.
Now she's back at work and back to the reality of life in the emergency department. Nurse Ebony's first patient is arriving by air ambulance. A man in his 30s, critically injured.
Can I take it? Thanks.
Senior emergency doctor Jonathan Papson will lead the trauma team of specialists called when a patient is critically injured.
We need to be ready for anything, it's the bottom line.
There's a gentleman coming who's been stabbed, and we think he might have stabbed himself or turned the knife on himself. And it sounds like he's been stabbed in his trunk somewhere. It might be his chest, it might be his abdomen.
The man has been acting erratically on the flight.
So often what the helicopter guys will do is they'll sedate people, and they might actually shackle them, so they'll put some restraints on their arms and legs so they won't be able to move around. You don't want a flailing patient in the back of a helicopter.
Some shackles, and we'll probably need security.
Dr. Jonathan and Nurse Ebony are worried the man might be a threat to the team's safety.
I think I can hear moaning already. That's not really a good sign.
So no surprise, we can hear the patient coming down the hallway before we can actually see him.
Hospital security stay with the man as he's wheeled into trauma two.
Hi, guys. How's things? Is it combative or is it just not cooperative?
It's just not high.
We'll get the whole picture. It's just not going to be straightforward. It's not going to be, hi, doc, here's my problem today. Please help me.
You're going to be all right there, buddy. Just have a lay back.
Just lay there here for me.
Hey, mate. You're just tied down.
Just lay down.
They have to move the man to the bed where he'll be restrained again so Dr. Jonathan can assess him.
Just rolling you onto the hospital bed, mate, okay? 1, 2, 3.
We actually need to get right up close to him and have a look and examine him. And the last thing you want is someone swinging a punch at you when you're trying to concentrate on looking at their chest or a wound. I mean, I'm not thinking about someone swinging a punch at me.
He's self-inflicted a single wound to his left upper quadrant just beneath his ribs.
Yep.
When police arrived at the scene, the patient was coherent but confused.
When they explained what had happened, he denied the incident. From there, they've apprehended him, and in that process, he's become acutely psychotic.
Right.
With the majority of his behaviour being completely irrational, laughing hysterically,
yes,
making
okay.
repetitive sounds, right. sort of singing at times.
Yeah, all right, thanks. Do you want to get that off and we'll have a look?
Yeah.
What do we reckon? Primary survey?
The entry on that left side has some subcut emphysema.
He does.
Dr. Jonathan is worried. Not only when he sees the penetrating wound, but also where it is.
It's over the cardiac silhouette. We can get an x-ray and see. Yeah. Have you looked at the heart?
Yeah.
Look, we're always concerned about a heart injury when people are stabbed in the trunk, because a heart injury or a penetrating injury in that area, over the area of the cardiac silhouette, can be life-threatening. You can die very quickly from a heart injury.
In the ambulance bay, paramedics are bringing in a 19-year-old with horrific injuries after falling from her horse.
We're just going to make sure we've got some suction around the place.
Emergency doctor Maya Cubitt has been warned the young girl has badly smashed her jaw.
So my worry about these facial fractures is just that there's a bit of bleeding. Whenever anybody is coming with significant facial injuries, the most important thing that we're concerned about is ongoing bleeding that might, for example, put her airway at risk or bleeding elsewhere in the body. Just pop your head back, lovely, and just try and keep nice and stiff.
Yeah.
It hurts when you lie back.
Yeah.
The question is, where is the pain coming from? Is it from the injuries that we can see, or is it from elsewhere, including, for example, cervical spine injuries or injuries in her brain or around her head that we haven't yet appreciated?
This is Charlie. She's a normally fit and well 19-year-old lady. Today was riding a horse, fell forwards off the horse,
yep.
and actually struck a log. Her family actually brought her out of the scrub. They were probably 500, 400 kilometres from here.
How did you end up on the ground, do you remember?
Horse knocked a log and a horse fell off.
So did you land on your face?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you having any trouble with your breathing?
No, not really.
Where's all of the fluid going? Do you feel anything pooling in the back of your mouth?
Oh, it's full. Yeah, it's pooling. Yeah.
Okay, lovely.
We'll give her some fluids, we'll get all the bloods and analgesia and we'll go from there.
Dr. David Fitter is also looking after Charlie.
Just without even having an image, I can tell that she's broken her jaw, broken part of her face, and there's quite a lot of blood in her mouth and in her throat.
And who knows that you're here?
I thought I think I'm dead.
I'm just going to have a look, OK?
Dr. Maya takes off the bandages to see what happened to the 19-year-old's face when she fell and slammed her chin into a log.
Can you try and open your mouth for me? That's as far as we get. OK. And do you feel like, without that there, that things are hanging down, or do you feel like things are sitting OK?
They're sort of just all locked in.
Feels locked in?
Yeah.
Like you can't open your jaw?
Yeah.
OK. So if you have facial fractures, not only can they put you at risk of quite significant bleeding, but they can put your airway at risk. And of course, if they're extensive, they can extend back into the base part of your skull. So it may actually be that she's got an intracranial injury.
Charlie's parents have begun the 2.5-hour drive to be with their daughter.
Sorry, lovely. Is there anything that you feel like you need to spit?
No, I just
feel really. You're going to
vomit? Maybe.
Can we get some antiemetic, David, please? So you've got this here. I want you to pop that there, all right? And if you start to feel like you need to vomit, that stuff helps suck it out, all right? I don't want you sending that back down the wrong way. You're right?
Yes.
She's got a face that is ripped apart, she's very sore, and she's about to vomit all the way through it. I cannot imagine how scared she must be feeling.
Oh, I'm just so overwhelmed.
can you hold her head, Nate? We just need to tip slightly that way. Gina, she's just going to spew, look.
In Trauma One, 19-year-old Charlie has shocking facial injuries after smashing her jaw on a log when she fell from her horse.
I'm sorry, that's really sore, isn't it?
Yeah. Just the process of opening her jaw to allow the vomit to come out is going to be very painful for her. And also, we don't yet know the extent of the other injuries around her head and her neck, and we'd like her to be moving as little as possible while this happens.
David, that vomit was all...
It was all digested blood, yeah.
Rushing to the hospital, Charlie's parents haven't spoken to their daughter since the accident.
I'm going to get you some more pain relief. What I need to do, if you can lie down.
Dr. Meyer and Dr. David need a CT scan to find out exactly what Charlie has done to her face.
Do you feel like you're swallowing anything at the moment? Okay.
Given that we have to lie her flat, we don't know whether she'll obstruct her airway at that point. And if she obstructs her airway, she can die.
All right, lovely, we're going to get you some pain relief. It is going to hurt.
Dr. David calls for an anaesthetist, just in case Charlie needs an emergency procedure to help her breathe.
We're worried that we're not going to be able to lie her down and get her flat to go in the scanner. It's quite an unstable fracture.
There's a chance that we might have to put her to sleep and give her an anaesthetic so that we can control her breathing with a breathing tube. We're getting the best person in the hospital to be able to potentially put a breathing tube down.
Hello, Charlie. My name's Ezra. I'm one of the anaesthetic doctors. Would you mind if I have a quick little look? I know you've probably done this a lot of times.
We're looking at the teeth, we're looking at the soft tissues, we're looking at the mouth opening, we're looking at the size of Charlie's tongue, we're looking further back into the soft palate to see how much we can see.
Do you feel like your voice is any different?
And then further down, ultimately, the place where we want to put the tube into the lungs is through the vocal cords. And how your voice sounds gives us an indication of whether there's likely any injury down there as well.
So I think seeing what happens when we lie bits by there is a good idea. We can just sit that back up again.
Yeah.
Dr. Ezra has given the team the all clear to try and lay Charlie flat while he stays close by.
All right, lovely, you hold my hand. So all we're doing is just trying to lie you down a little bit.
Yep. So if you feel that it's hard to breathe or you're not feeling right, you just tell it.
Awesome.
Super trooper.
Yeah. You're doing really well.
All right, Gina, do you want to get ready to go to CT?
Yep, I've got everything.
As Charlie goes for scans, Dr. Meyer calls her mum.
She's okay, she's very sore, but she hasn't needed any significant resuscitation. She just has a really nasty wound and fracture, obviously, of her jaw.
Charlie's mum needs some reassurance that actually, although the injuries are pretty horrific, they're not immediately life-threatening. I can't imagine what it must be like to be a mum so far away from an injured child.
But she's okay, and she would be able to talk to you, but she's just wheeled out of the bay, okay?
How you going there, buddy?
Over in Trauma 2, a man has a serious stab wound close to his heart. He may also have taken an unknown substance that has left him in a psychotic state and difficult to treat.
Okay, so that's worked nicely, the ketamine.
Dr. Jonathan is giving him more medication to try and keep him still for the x-rays.
Lay down, Nate. Lay down.
But more drugs are needed.
Go with fibrodropyl IV, please. See what that does.
He's erratic, he's trying to jump off the bed, he's difficult to manage. He just needs to sit still just for like 1 second to get an x-ray. You just press the button, bang, get an x-ray. He's not actually sitting still for that 1 second. That's a problem.
Jeez, he is strong.
Nurse Ebony is helping to sedate the man who, it's believed, harmed himself.
Okay, 5-hydroperidol's in.
We are giving him medication to help settle him down, but we don't want to push him over the edge. We still want him to be able to respond to us to know that he is okay. What happens if we give them too much sedation is that they can stop breathing.
Yeah.
Not knowing the man's history makes it difficult for Dr. Jonathan to know what medications he can tolerate.
So he's just had the droperidol and the ketamine. Yeah.
I don't know what prior history this man has. He might be a diabetic, he might have kidney problems, he might have heart problems. I don't know any of that. You could die from any medicine that the doctor injects into you if you're allergic to it. That can happen very quickly. So it's a minute-by-minute proposition to see how he's reacting.
Do you want to sit him up, Ebony, see whether he just put the bed up to 30 degrees?
Yep.
Dr. Jonathan needs x-rays to see if the man's heart or abdomen have been pierced. Both are life-threatening.
Lay down, mate.
The stab wound is in a dangerous place.
And that might have hit bowel or one of the organs in the abdomen, and that needs an operation. He could be in a really serious amount of trouble.
That's another 30 ketamine. I'm flushed.
At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, emergency doctor Emma West is getting ready to receive a critically injured patient.
We've just had a phone call from Air Ambulance. They're bringing in a 19-year-old man who's coming from rural Victoria. He's been involved in a motorbike accident.
Did you hear the story?
Motorbike accident, flew 15 metres, 19-year-old.
Yeah.
Emergency doctor Luke Delarue takes the case.
Hey, just so you know, chopper's just landed. This trauma alert's arriving very shortly.
We unfortunately see the full gamut of traumatic injuries from motorbike accidents. Obviously, the most catastrophic and worrying things that we see would be head injury, which is largely irreversible.
Hey, mate, how you doing?
Good, yourself?
Good, I'm Luke. I'm one of the doctors. We're going to get you across and hear a story, all right? Comfortable? Yeah.
Things off, mate. I'm
going to
hand your phone over to this.
Hanging onto the phone is always a good sign when patients come in holding onto their phone. iPhone sign positive is what we call it. It means someone's awake and alert and thinking about their loved ones.
The team has to be careful moving Kevin in case he has spinal injuries.
So Kev is a 19-year-old fella.
Yep.
Mechanism today, riding a motorbike with full protective equipment, helmet. He's just travelling in about a 90-kilometre zone. He was being followed by his dad driving a caravan.
Yep.
He's gone through an intersection. He states he did not see the stop sign. He got cleaned up by a small sedan. Significant damage to the front of the car and windscreen damage where his head and body's gone into it.
Kevin's dad was driving behind his son, towing a caravan. They were heading to a campsite to set up for a family holiday.
I saw Kev, he's in front of me, and he went over a railway crossing, and he didn't see stop signs, neither did I. Instant thought was death, because that's what I saw.
According to witnesses, they said he was thrown about 15 to 20 metres from the actual point of impact, cartwheeled into a ditch.
It was described by bystanders that initially Kevin was unconscious when his father got to him, and then he regained consciousness whilst he was in the field before the paramedics arrived, which is a good sign. But it doesn't exclude serious head injury, and so that's something that I still am really concerned about.
Dr. Luke can hardly believe Kevin's reasonably alert, considering he was thrown 15 metres into the air.
Look all the way up for you, look down, on the right, he's going to the left.
He's clearly been hit with really significant force, and to see Kevin in front of me awake and talking is pretty remarkable.
Is there anything you guys can do about my heel?
My heel is very sore.
I can see that he's got clearly an open fracture where the bones come out through the skin. We know that with open fractures, the bone being exposed to the outside world, contaminating a wound, that's really something that can cause problems, particularly given that the bone is broken and will need to be fixed by putting in some metal rods, and so that increases his risk of infection even further.
Tom, how are we doing, primary-wise?
Kevin's dad, Robert, who was at the scene, cannot believe his son survived.
You know, as I stopped, I walked past the car, mate, and I saw the damage to the vehicle. Bonnet twisted, all the plastic bumper bars all over the ground, and that was an impact of great proportion to me. I didn't expect to stop the dude in the middle of the road, go back, walk up to him, and him still speeding.
Fast looks negative so far. We'll go chest and pelvis, and we'll go around the scale.
Yeah.
Dr. Luke is expecting to find more than a fractured heel, with the 19-year-old striking the car with enough force to remove the bull bar.
It's very easy to get distracted by the gory open fracture, and whilst we need to deal with that, the main concern or the main reason that he would deteriorate in front of me is actually from bleeding that I can't see.
So we're going to do an X-ray. If you want without lead, step out. Ebony, put him up.
In trauma two, the team has been struggling to X-ray a man who is psychotic. He has a potentially deadly stab wound.
So there often isn't blood coming out of a stab wound. You have to hit a major blood vessel to have blood pouring out. So people don't tend to die from bleeding from the stab wound. They die from whatever inside has been injured.
Well, the sedation's working.
It's working.
Yep.
The man finally succumbs to the strong medication required to keep him sedated for the X-ray. Dr. Papson suspects the man has a punctured lung or damage to his abdomen.
Do you want to whack the oxygen up a bit?
One of the reasons I'm getting him to sit up is to see whether there's air in the wrong spot. If he's got air under the diaphragm, it means that the stab wound's actually gone into the abdomen, and that might have hit bowel or one of the organs in the abdomen. So I'll get a lot of information if I get that erect chest X-ray.
That's what that is.
Yeah. Yep, there's air under that diaphragm, which means he's got a penetrating injury to his abdomen, and that just about mandates an operation.
You're okay, buddy. We're just having a look, right?
Yeah.
It's just around here, and it goes, so it's over the cardiac silhouette.
Surgeon Rose is assessing the patient.
Just go for laparotomy. Okay, thanks, Rose.
It's now time to put him under the anaesthetic that we've been trying to avoid, but let's do it, because he's going to have the anaesthetic anyway. So let's get some situation control, get him ready for an operation. Let's intubate him.
150 of ketamine, 150 of rocuronate.
He just needs a sat probe on, if that's okay.
Okay, drugs are in. You're on the clock.
When we intubate someone, we put the tube into the trachea, which then the air can go into the lungs, and then we bag them to actually breathe for them. Because he won't breathe by himself. I've given him drugs that'll stop him breathing.
Is he out?
And then once we're happy that everything is as it should be, then we put him on the ventilator.
Okay, so that's on. So you can unclamp the tube and you can start ventilating.
The patient is on his way to theatre so surgeons can save his life. For Dr. Papson and the team, these sorts of cases come with the job in a busy ED.
Ready?
All right, let's go. The fact of the matter is those things happen out there and people are psychotic and people suffer from mental illnesses. So if I thought about all the terrible things I'd seen all the time, you'd be a wreck.
How's it been, Evan?
Pretty okay. Yeah,
not too bad.
For Dr. Tessa Smith, the ED is a change of scenery.
I'm normally a paediatric emergency doctor, but as part of our training, we come back to adults for at least 12 months, so I'm in the midst of doing that at the moment.
Dr. Tessa's bubbly personality has helped her fit right in with the team.
Our work is very challenging and it's very, very easy to get burnt out. And I think our biggest point of resilience is who we're working with. And if we have a good team that we can, in between patients, have a laugh with or give a smile down the corridors we walk past, it really makes you just keep pushing because it's never ending in this line of work. You've got to find something to keep you going on the hard days.
Dr. Tessa turns her skills to emergency medicine, with Air Ambulance bringing in a 64-year-old almond farm worker from northern Victoria.
There's a man coming who's had a fall from a forklift and landed straight on his head. there's always the possibility that this head injury has caused internal bleeding within the head, and that can be life-ending.
Graham, just going to put the back of the chair down, buddy. We're going to roll. You're not going to move. It's nice and still.
When Graham comes in, I see that he is talking, which is an immediate initial sigh of relief. But I can see he's got a very large bandage on his head and he does seem to be in some degree of pain.
All right, so this is Graham. He was in a forklift and it's rolled and he's fallen through the window.
Yep.
He's fallen about 2 metres directly onto his head on really solid ground.
Yep.
Do you feel short of breath?
A little bit.
Yes. Graham was covering almond trees with a tarpaulin when a big gust of wind blew his forklift over and he fell 2.5 metres onto his head.
What we've done, if you're wondering what that is, it's another rolled up bandage actually inside.
Some pressure. Okay.
Pressure got a little bit too much, so we've had to cut up a little bit for him.
Yep. There's some pulsatile blood, so an artery has been damaged and is bleeding. That does cause me some concern because arteries have higher pressure blood going through them, and if we don't control bleeding from an artery, a patient can eventually bleed out from that type of injury.
It's a pretty big fall you've had. We want to make sure that you don't have any other wounds, all right, or any other injuries. We're going to scan you from your head all the way down to your pelvis to have a look at for internal injuries, all right?
What I'm particularly worried about with that type of injury is, have we got a bleed around the brain or damage to the brain or the skull, as well as that artery bleeding?
One, two, three.
At the Royal Melbourne Emergency Department, young horse rider Charlie is being scanned for any life-threatening injuries. Charlie fell from her horse and slammed her jaw into a log, totally disfiguring her face. Her 2-metre fall may have left her with internal injuries as well.
Is she okay? You guys are happy?
Yeah, she seems comfortable. She nodded, thumbs up.
The worry for Dr. Maya and Dr. David is that Charlie could develop problems breathing in the CT because of the debilitating injuries to her face.
Doesn't look good, does it?
I always have to remain vigilant. You know, something might move in her throat or she might still vomit or something might happen that would mean that she loses her airway.
All done?
All done, good. You okay, Charlie?
Yeah.
Charlie makes it through the scans with no problems.
Yeah, we just sit up a little bit. Yeah.
The muscles are probably going to spasm a little bit. It's going to hurt. Okay, you've really been very brave, yeah. My friend.
I'm going to stay down.
You want to stay down when it's cold?
You stay down? Yeah.
Yeah.
So the CT scan confirms that Charlie has extensive facial fractures on both sides of her face and significantly in the cheekbones, also into the jaw and the jaw socket of her right side of her face, which is why she's having trouble moving it, and then fractures that extend into the base of her skull. But luckily, no fractures in her cervical spine and no injury to her brain that we can see. And there doesn't appear to be any ongoing bleeding, which is fantastic.
Charlie's back from her scan, so I'll just give you the phone to her.
Charlie's parents are still on their way, but at last they get to hear their daughter's voice.
Hello. Oh, my gosh.
Oh. So next steps for Charlie will be the maxillofacial team, the plastic surgical team, and a neurosurgical team having a look at the scans and deciding what surgery she needs and within what time frame. At some point, Charlie will need quite extensive surgery to fix the injuries we can see.
Okay.
So Charlie will need some extensive dental work as well. It will be a painful road, but she will get there in the end.
You're all right, Mum, okay?
Yeah.
Yeah. No worries. That's what family's for, friend.
Yeah.
Right.
Hello.
Hello.
There you go.
Over in Resus Bay 6, word's out that almond farm worker Graham fell from a forklift while at work. And the 64-year-old's phone is running hot.
I can't talk, I'm in hospital.
Yeah,
no, what's going on? Who told you? I felt better.
Dad's a old school country boy. Doesn't, you know, share emotions or, you know, doesn't like people fussing over him. People that know him would know that he's got a good heart and he's a good person. But I think the exterior certainly paints you know, a bit more of a standoffish and I'm okay, leave me be kind of persona.
No. You just go spend time with your kids, I'll be wrong.
While Graham is downplaying his accident, Dr. Tessa isn't. She suspects a head injury or spinal injuries.
Graham, how this works is I'm going to press down all the levels on your back. You just use your words yes or no if there's pain, OK?
Yep. We're on three, one, two, three.
Beautiful. All right. Graham, is there pain when I'm pressing up here?
You can't even feel it.
Good. Yes or no?
No.
You feel me touching here?
Yep.
Squeeze your bottom together for me. Fabulous.
By rolling Graham, the team discovers he's bleeding badly from his bandaged head.
I can actually see that this scalp wound that I thought was the bleeding was under control is actually bleeding down through the pressure bandage and onto the bed.
Yep.
With trauma surgical registrar James May assisting, the bandages applied by paramedics are taken off to reveal what's happened to Graham's head.
So, Graham, what we're going to do now, we're going to take this person off the head and we're going to wash it.
I'm just cutting the bandage, OK? The scissors aren't going near your skin. They did a tight one.
Good, aren't they?
I'm not surprised. You just keep your head still for us, Graham. Let us do the work.
As she removes the bandages, Dr. Tessa is astounded at what she sees.
I'm taking the bandage off and I was very shocked and quite confused. I start to pull something away that was red. His entire scalp and skull had kind of been all matted with dirt and was just crumbling away in my hands. And I stood there for a moment looking at it going, I don't know what's going on here.
Oh, wow.
Good mother, huh?
Yeah.
You did.
The other bloke.
They did. We might need a bin.
His colleagues on site had actually tried to stop the bleeding by getting the red mud from the farm and patting it in the wound.
I was not expecting that. Yeah, just run some water.
Just a bit of water on you.
Bit cold.
You have to smile at the insane things we sometimes see in emergency. The next thought in my head is if this wound is full of mud, this is a recipe for infection.
To
anything?
No. Okay. Try and keep your head nice and still for us, darling.
Across the corridor, 19-year-old Kevin has had a catastrophic accident learning to ride his motorbike. Dr. Luke is caring for the teenager, whose bike and a car collided, causing Kevin to smash into the windscreen before being tossed into the air.
I'm going to see if I can push these shorts off.
Yeah, that's it.
Do you attach them particularly?
No, I've got nothing underneath, though.
That's okay. Nothing we haven't seen.
Yeah.
Given the mechanism of injury, I'm really worried about him bleeding in the chest, in the abdomen, or from pelvic fractures. Additionally, we worry about his head, and I really worry about his spine after being hit by a car at that speed.
Can I ask, when they gave you that medication, when you're in the ditch on the side of the road, do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember that.
Despite his horrific accident, remarkably, Kevin is talking to Dr. Luke.
How did you go with that medication? Did it make you feel a bit spaced out? Or?
Yeah, it made me feel a bit spaced out.
In a bad way or an okay way?
No, an okay way. I wasn't in as much pain.
Yeah, we'll try a little bit of that as well, yeah. Just to see if we can get on top of your pain, because we're going to take you around a CT, you have to move you onto the table and those kind of things.
So far, they know the young learner rider has an extremely painful open fracture to his ankle.
Thanks. Just that medication, okay? You might feel a bit weird.
Any movement through the fracture site itself can be quite excruciating, and so we make sure he's got enough pain relief on board to help with that. But obviously it's really important to clean out the wound as well, and so we need to get that done.
Bit of a sting, okay, mate? You okay?
Yeah. I just feel weird.
I know, it's the medication for the pain, okay? It'll make you feel a bit spacey.
Yeah.
Think happy thoughts.
Yeah.
Imagine you're not here.
Perfect.
Go back down. Beautiful. You okay?
Yeah.
All right.
The team need to get Kevin to CT as soon as possible to rule out any internal injuries that may endanger his life.
Horrific injury. Like, horrific,
I know. He's got thrown 15 metres or something.
Yeah, the photo. He's just a big bullseye in the front of the car on the screen.
Oh, yeah. My God.
Dad Robert feels enormous relief his son beat the odds.
You know, thank God he's here. After seeing what you saw and he's still breathing, it was just relief. My dear, he was all right.
You're all right. Doing well. Just going to do that CT, OK?
Yeah.
All right, we're going to do all the work. You stay nice and still.
Do what you guys have to and I'll be right.
Yeah, we're happy.
He was tolerating things amazingly considering he had, you know, a really nasty fracture of his leg. He's a tough kid.
Visibly blunt chest.
While Kevin is being scanned, the emergency alarm goes off.
Who's that?
There's something wrong with the 19-year-old. At the Royal Melbourne Hospital, an alarm is going off in the CT, alerting staff who rush in to assist.
When the alarm goes off in CT, we always have to assume the worst. Fortunately, on this occasion, it was just some vomiting, but vomiting in this setting can be potentially quite bad. Kevin's still in full spinal precautions, so if he does vomit, he can't clear his own airway and he can choke on that.
The 19-year-old may have life-threatening internal injuries, which is why he's being scanned.
All the scans done or just the top half?
Not all of it was done.
How's he feeling now?
He's feeling a little bit better than your wife.
He's going to go to X-ray now.
While Dr. Luke waits for the scan results, Kevin is taken for X-rays to get a clear and more definitive look at his badly fractured ankle, which has a bone piercing through the skin.
Is everyone okay, man?
Kevin's horrific accident and the medication could be making him ill, but it could also be a sign of other injuries. With Kevin's nausea peaking again, the emergency alarm goes off for a second time, and senior emergency doctor Emma West lends a hand.
How are you? You just can't stop vomiting, right? Yeah. What's he had for nausea? Yeah.
When a patient involved in a motorbike accident is vomiting, there's always a chance that it's occurring because of a significant head injury. So bleeding on the brain is actually a cause of persistent vomiting. So now I'm really concerned that Kevin could have a head injury.
How do you feel?
Sore.
Sore. Just try and keep your neck up. So where are you sore in your leg, obviously?
Down where my calf is, from knee to calf.
Yeah, pretty sore. Do you still feel sick?
Not really.
Does it come on you all of a sudden?
Yeah.
Does it? Okay. We can try some Maxilon.
So he probably just needs a bit of time, I think.
Yes, I think so.
Bring him back and sit him.
Yeah, he's just having two more x-rays and then he'll come back.
Kevin's, he's remained stable whilst he's been with us in ED. So his numbers have remained stable. His conscious state has remained pretty stable. He's still alert, he's still orientated. And despite having, you know, a lot of vomiting, he actually feels not too bad after some pain relief.
Photos of the accident scene show the 19-year-old has seemingly defied the odds.
Fortunately, the CT results are really reassuring. So he doesn't have any signs of head injury. He doesn't have any signs of chest, abdominal or pelvic trauma either. And fortunately, it looks as if he's just got an isolated fracture of his tibia.
You OK? How's that medication?
Yeah.
It's good stuff, yeah?
Yeah.
Kevin's tibia or shin bone has a nasty break, but it being the only injury he's suffered is a miracle.
Why are we not worse than it is?
Yeah, lucky. Probably
be a
fractured
quite
a little bit, I think.
If I really leave, we've already got a wooden chair.
So the next step for Kevin will be that he needs to have a formal washout of the open fracture and the wound. The orthopaedic surgeons will place a rod to help fix the bones together again. Yeah, it's a big operation and it's a big recovery. So he'll be off his leg for at least 6 weeks, I would imagine.
Brian, you
you to see now, okay? This is just that injection that you were talking about there.
Over in Resus 6, Dr. Tessa has called on trauma surgeon Dr. James May to clean and stitch the bleeding wound on Graham's head that has been packed with mud.
Luckily, the mud was all on the back and the wound was all on the side, so miraculously no mud in the actual wound, which is great.
Whose hand do I got?
Sorry?
You're okay?
It's all right? It's
me.
Just a bit of a wash now?
Yeah.
Sorry, mate.
The skin of the scalp has a very rich blood supply, and many arteries supply the scalp. And so any time that the skin is cut in that area, it tends to bleed quite profusely. Graham also managed to sever one of the vessels running underneath the scalp, and we have some arterial bleeding coming from that point. And it's really important that we identify the full extent of the wound, because we need to make sure it's clean, and we also need to stop it from bleeding before he goes up to the ward.
You feeling pain or just pulling?
Just pulling and pain, yeah. Yes.
Pulling or pain?
All pain.
Pretty hard to see the exact vessel.
See it.
With these big sutures that we're using to try and stop the bleeding from these particular blood vessels, that they would eventually have to be removed on the ward and revised so that the wound can be cleaned out again, and to make sure that there's no other ongoing issues.
Well, that's good, we're all done. Well, you did well. We're going to get rid of all this dirt and stuff for you, give you a bit of a wash. You're going to have to roll you on your side to do it, and then we'll change over that colour and bandage you up good.
Graham still needs to go to CT to see if he has any other life-threatening injuries.
We've dealt with Graham's acute bleeding from his scalp wound, but I'm still worried that there might be bleeding within the head. I'm worried that there might be injuries of the chest or the abdomen.
Resus 6, Dr. Tessa Smith receives scan results for 64-year-old forklift driver Graham.
We found he's unfortunately sustained quite a few injuries from his fall. The scalp wound that we already knew about, he also has 9 different rib fractures down the left-hand side, and he's fractured multiple bones in his spine as well.
Are you okay? Do you need anything else?
No.
Graham's going to need to be seen by the orthopaedic team to make a decision about whether these fractures are stable or whether we are worried about his spinal cord, and then they will guide the management from there.
Dr. Jonathan's patient had critical injuries from a self-inflicted stab wound.
It's over the cardiac silhouette. We can get an x-ray and see.
The knife had pierced the man's diaphragm and gone into his bowel. He was intubated and rushed to theatre for life-saving surgery. Surgeons successfully repaired his bowel, and he was discharged the following day under supervision.
Can you try and open your mouth for me?
19-year-old Charlie badly smashed her jaw after falling from her horse.
Are you going to vomit?
No.
It's really sore.
Okay, we need some pain relief.
Worried Charlie could have trouble breathing in the scanner, Dr. David had an anaesthetist on standby in case he needed to put in a breathing tube. Scans revealed the extent of Charlie's injuries.
Charlie went on to have quite extensive surgery of her face, including some plates and some reconstructive surgery and some dental work.
Charlie is now recuperating at home, back happily with her horses. Dr. Tessa's patient, Graham, fell 2.5 metres from a forklift and landed on his head.
It's a pretty big fall you've had. We want to make sure that you don't have any other wounds.
After cleaning and suturing the wound, scans revealed Graham had rib and spine fractures.
After talking to the orthopaedic doctors, they've thankfully deemed that these fractures within his spine are stable. He doesn't need an operation and he's safe to walk around. He will have some pain, however, so pain management is going to be really important.
I can't talk, I'm in hospital.
After 2 days in hospital, Graham was able to go home with his son Tyler, hopeful he'll slow up just a little.
I'd hope that it It at least makes him think twice about something or situations in the future, but as an old country boy, you can't teach an old dog new tricks, so whether or not it does actually change his approach, you will never know.
I'm Luke, I'm one of the doctors. We're going to get you across and hear a story, all right?
19-year-old Kevin had a catastrophic accident while learning to ride a motorbike.
Tom, how are we doing, primary-wise?
Dr. Luke was worried Kevin may have head and spinal injuries as well as the open fracture to his ankle.
Listen, you guys can do it via my heel is very sore.
That's a good girl, bro.
Yes, I do consider myself extremely fortunate. It's a pretty big thing to happen and walk away from it.
It's been 11 weeks since Kevin's accident, and he's very happy to be back on both feet.
Yeah.
Oh. It meant so much that my father was there by my side when it happened. If he wasn't there, I don't know what I would have done.
Health-wise, hasn't been too bad at all. Apart from, just the pain, he's pretty good. He handled it well. Handled it very well. Not a lot of people can go through all that.
Going for my car license soon, and then see if I can jump back on a bike, which would be pretty amazing, to be honest with you.
Next Monday, after the block.
In comes this really serious case.
A family camping trip.
He's been struck by a one-ton trailer.
Takes a tragic turn.
I imagine families terrified. I'm so sorry this is happening.
Can this father of four...
It's pretty clear things are really bad.
...pull through for his kids?
We need to move very, very quickly. Every second counts.
All new emergency next Monday after the block on 9.